Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the regular business meeting of Reading City Council here on Monday, November 14th. Our invocation this evening is going to be with Rabbi Matthew Abelson from Kesher Zion Synagogue. We will then remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Good evening. The selection that I've chosen for the invocation is from the Book of Psalms, which tradition teaches us is written by King David, chapter 66, verses 16 through 20. Come and hear, all God-fearing men, as I tell what he did for me. I called aloud to him, glorification on my tongue. Had I an evil thought in my mind, the Lord would not have listened. But God did listen. He paid heed to my prayer. Blessed is God who has not turned away my prayer or his faithful care from me. The verse that I want to focus on is verse 18. The Hebrew reads, Aven im ra'iti b'libi lo yishma Adonai. Had I an evil thought in my mind, the Lord would not have listened. The task of the council is to do. In order to be able to do, we must listen to one another. Unlike God, whose doing and listening take place simultaneously, for us humans, listening and doing are two separate activities. In order to be able to do this evening what is before us on the agenda for the council, let us listen with an open heart to one another.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Mr. Galbert?
Here.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Here.
Mr. Marbrew?
Here.
Ms. Reed?
Here.
Mr. Slipko?
Here.
Mr. Twyman?
Present.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Here.
Seven present, none absent.
Okay, first item, we have one proclamation this evening. I'm going to ask the mayor and vice president of the city council, Donna Reed, and Brian to meet me at the podium.
What is it,
Good evening. It's a pleasure for me to give this commendation to the city of Reading and to announce on America's Recycling Day this commendation from City Council and the Mayor. Today, the City of Reading Council recognizes America Recycles Day. Whereas November 15th, America Recycles Day, is the only nationally recognized day dedicated to encouraging Americans to recycle and buy recycled products. And whereas America's Recycling Day is celebrating its 47th year and has grown to include millions of Americans pledging to increase their recycling habits at home, at work, and to buy products made with recycled materials. And whereas America's Recycled Day works to increase awareness of the environmental benefits of curbside, industrial, and community recycling programs. And whereas the City of Reading began its recycling program in 1991 and currently collects 2,223 tons of commingled recycling, 960 tons of paper and cardboard, 14 tons of electronics, 8.1 tons of tires, and 200 tons of yard waste, keeping these items from landfills. Now, therefore, the City of Reading commends as follows. It's with great honor that the City of Reading recognizes the success of Reading's recycling program. Furthermore, Council calls upon the citizens of Reading to work together to reuse and to recycle and to help the environment achieve sustainability.
Thank you.
I'll speak rather briefly on recycling. It's my pleasure to advocate for recycling for the last 5 years. I've worked in the Reading School District for the last 4 to 5 years to encourage this program that is now an intergovernmental relationship between the Reading School District and the City of Reading. They've done a wonderful job collecting recycling, encouraged recycling, and having continued outstanding efforts in the city. Previous administration was able to bring this recycling program in-house, create a number of jobs, which benefits directly the citizens and local individuals in our community. I'm really proud of the recycling program, having worked there for the last 3 years. I think we can do a lot better, and I think we can continue to encourage recycling at our lowest level. And that education starts in the home. It starts with our children, and it continues in our homes every day with all of our residents. I think we do a really, really good job in Reading, especially the way that our residents are able to split paper with commingled material. It's one of the most important things that happens in Reading. It happens to be rather particular to Reading. A lot of municipalities and cities in the state of Pennsylvania have chosen to go single stream. And I really think that there's a lot of benefits to dual stream recycling. It's important to know that in the coming years, things have changed so much and are changing so much that we're going to have to make a lot of really hard decisions. So I hope we continue recycling. I hope we continue educating our residents and our children to keep up with this effort. So on that note, great job to the City of Reading.
I just want to add, Brian here is being kind of modest. He's a former member of the team. Brian is a driver here in the city for the sustainability and the recycling program. And while he was a presenter tonight, he is also a major advocate, and I just want to congratulate Brian on what he does here as well. Thank you, Brian.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Our next item on our agenda is our public comment. We have 11 speakers this evening. Let's see if I counted that right. Four. Nine speakers this evening, four of which are on agenda matters. Is there any objection from council to hear from all nine speakers at this time? If not, Chris, do you mind reading all our public speaking guidelines, please? Thank you.
Citizens attending council meetings are expected to conduct themselves in a responsible and respectful manner that does not disrupt the meeting. Those wishing to have a conversation should do so in the hall outside council chambers in a low speaking voice. Public comment will occur only during the public comment period listed on the agenda at the podium and must be directed to council as a body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Clapping, calling out, and/or cheering when a speaker finishes his comments is not permitted. Citizens may not approach the council tables at any time during the meeting. Any person making threats of any type, personally offensive or impertinent remarks, or any person becoming unruly while addressing council may be barred or called to order by the presiding officer, may be barred from speaking, removed from council chambers, and or cited. Failure to abide by these regulations could result in your removal from council chambers and or a citation. These regulations are meant to avoid disruptions at the meeting, and they are not meant to interfere with public participation.
Thank you, Chris. Our first speaker this evening is Mr. Brian McMahon, and the topic is the wastewater treatment plant. Brian, if you could do me a favor and adjust that podium a little bit towards us. Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. And you have up to 5 minutes.
Okay, great. Thank you. Great. Good evening. Brian McMahon from Steamfitters Union, and I represent over 300 members that live in Berks County. I see the other day that the WFMZ did a story on the wastewater treatment project and quoted someone from the city, and this is the article. Someone from the city saying that they hope that the Bethlehem company that has the wastewater treatment plant will hire workers from Berks County. Mr. Mayor, Mr. Steckman, City Council, and the City of Reading, This wastewater treatment plant could have been built with all Berks County workers. All you had to do was sign on to the project labor agreement. And guess what? The wastewater treatment plant would have been halfway done by now. Instead, you believe the lies of the Associated Builders and Contractors, the Chamber of Commerce, the local press, and now you're hoping that companies hire Berks County workers. Hope for local jobs when it could have been done the first time. Sure, you're going to save $5.6 million savings on this project right now, which amounts to 3% savings, and the project is still $29 million over budget. At the last council meeting, Mr. Steckman made a statement that there were over 60 contractors that could have bid the wastewater treatment plant. So what I did was, since I attended the pre-bid at that job, my name is signed in, my email, I was emailed a copy of these. So Mr. Steckman was saying that there were 60 contractors on this list that could have bid that project. So I went on the computer and looked up every contractor that signed in. A lot of them, you can't even understand who they are. You got to really sift through it. So with Mr. Steckman's number, there's 58 companies that are vendors or suppliers for equipment. They can't even bid the project in any capacity for the general construction, the plumbing, the HVAC, or the electrical. So that brings you down to 18 contractors that bid this, that could have been the, bid this project, that could have bid the project. There were four general contractors that could have bid the project. Only two bid it. There were six electrical contractors who could have bid the job. Four bid it. There were four plumbing contractors that could have bid the project, and only two bid it. And there were four HVAC contractors that could have bid the project, and only one bid that project. So, Mr. Steckman, your numbers are so far off the mark. I hope that you double-check and triple-check your numbers going forward for this city and all endeavors. At the last city council meeting, Mayor Scott made a statement that the union contractors had their chance to bid the project and didn't bid it, and now since we saw the open shop bid numbers, we want to bid it again. Bid it again was in sarcasm, of course. But Mr. Mayor, you are wrong, dead wrong. Mr. Mayor, you would not let me enlighten you after the last meeting. You acted like a child.
Hold on. Tom.
Okay.
Brian, listen.
Okay.
It's okay to address people's statements.
Okay.
It is not okay to attack anyone personally.
Fine. I'm sorry.
All right.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
An apology would be appreciated.
I just did. I said I was sorry.
For me, too.
Mr. Mayor, you would not let me enlighten you after the last council meeting. Your facts are wrong. The true fact is that the union contractors bid the wastewater treatment plant two times without any open shop bidders bidding the project. So, Mr. Mayor, the open shop contractor saw the union contractor's numbers two times, and then they decided to bid it the third time. Seems to me that some people around here can say whatever they want to say, but they're going to be held accountable for what they say. Thank you. Mr. Steckman, I apologize.
Thank you.
Okay, just to clarify the rules that were read as far as addressing council, that the comments should be directed to council as a body, not to any individual council member or public elected official in attendance.
Yeah, I want to reiterate that. It's okay to quote somebody, but not to address or attack anyone. So let's keep that in mind moving forward this evening. Our next speaker this evening is Mr. Ryan Helms, and the topic is the wastewater treatment plant. Good evening, Ryan. You have up to 5 minutes as well, please.
Good evening, Council, Mr. Mayor. Ryan Helms, Building Trades President, Business Manager of the Electricians Union. You've seen me here before. It's the same old story. I was at your committee of the whole meeting earlier, and I heard someone comment about this has been going on for 12 plus years, and it has been a long time. I go way back with it. In that time, Governor Rendell was in place. It was Mayor McMahon at the time. Katie McGinney was with DEP here in the state. I think some of the council members might have been on board at that time yet. I could remember back to that time. And they had come to us as the building trades and asked us to get involved with this project. Project labor agreement was in the discussion as well. It was committed that this is something that we should employ on this project, being a very large scale project. Something else that they had talked to us about is utilizing, creating a program with the inner city youth. We did that with United Community Services here locally by giving local at-risk youth an opportunity at a career in our building trades, in our apprenticeships. And we did that. We did that successfully. I heard that commented earlier tonight at the Committee of the Whole meeting about how they wanted to implement a program and internships to get people involved now. I find it really ironic that people are on the council are actually starting to talk about being concerned about local jobs and getting local business involved. It's a little too late in this case, because now you're about to award to a two contractors are locally, but they're very small contracts compared to the two larger contracts in question in this job, the general contracting electrical. But I find it really disturbing. Now at this point in time, we want to talk like we're concerned about local jobs. Well, the building trades came to this council years ago this started, and only in the last couple of years, we came here and had a workshop with this council. Most of you were here, not all of you, but we sat here as the building trades and had a candid discussion publicly, and there was business sector people here, and we were here as the trades, and we shared documentation, studies, facts, rulings from federal judges with the PLAs are legal, facts that show that PLAs help communities. And it's the bottom line is we just want to create local jobs. We want to keep jobs here. We want to educate people here. We have a situation here in this city. We're noted as one of the poorest cities in this country, and we can't even help ourselves right here. When we had the opportunity, we presented an opportunity for you as a council to help the citizens that live here in this city and around this county to try something different, to create jobs here, keep the local tax dollars here, spend money on the businesses here. But no, you listen to the business interests out there, the ABC, the chamber, and other entities that wanted to talk us down, and you believed in them. And we got vilified by the press, by those business groups, by this council, as like we were doing something wrong and suggesting something wrong. Well, I can't disagree more with that. And right now, you're tonight, you're still on the cusp of awarding a project that's basically almost $29 million over budget, bottom line. And all you're doing is all you did was loan more money and put the city in further debt. And you already have enough issues to deal with, so as it is. There's no doubt about that. But I think it's time you start. I mean, maybe it's too late for this job, but you still got the future to consider. And our door's open. So if you want to try a better way, come look us up sometime. Because what you're doing now, I don't think is a very good financial or civic responsibility to the citizens of this city. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ryan. Okay. Our next speaker this evening is Mr. Bill Doward, and the topic is the wastewater treatment plant. Good evening, Bill. You have up to 5 minutes as well, sir.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
You have up to 5 minutes.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Council. My name is Bill Doward. I'm a representative with the Sheet Metal Workers Local 19. I'm here tonight over this project, which is a very important issue to a lot of people. The citizens of Reading and also the community of workers in which we reside. It should mean even more to this administration because of the tax base that because of the tax base. We, the workers, live here, work here, and spend our money here. Now, because of the removal of the project labor agreement, you have contractors coming in from other areas and will be taking that tax base somewhere else. Tonight, I looked up the poorest cities in the state of Pennsylvania. Are you aware that Reading is the fourth on this list? The city of Reading was a booming city at one point because of the labor force it had. Due to the decline of labor unions because of big business and companies moving out of this great country to put more money in their pockets. Now is the time to start helping the community by putting our people who live here to work here. There's been talk about the PLAs raising the cost of a project by 25 to 30%. When in fact, if I looked at the bid numbers, there was only a savings of roughly 3.9%. This project is still well over budget. This city loses a lot of money when our community and our contractors don't work here. Please think about this in the future. That's what we're about as labor unions. We're about the community, the workforce, the military. We have programs in our building trades program where our military comes back from overseas and they get first crack at it. We are not the big bad wolf of which we've been portrayed as. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Wanda Negron, and the topic is homeless and ashes to beauty. That is a non-agenda item. Wanda, good evening. You have up to 3 minutes this evening, okay? You mind adjusting your microphone there a little bit? Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you? Yes, I'm here to talk about our program. We're Ashes to Beauty program, where I have a facilitator, a person in charge of it is Jolana Mendoza Pasta. We help the homeless. We feed them, we clothe them, we service them on Wednesday, we feed them and we give them Bible classes. And on Sunday, we feed them as well and we give them service. We started this program, she started, Yolanda Mendoza, by going to the community. I don't know if you know well aware of. We don't tell you right now because they could be, you know, pushed out of there. She reached them, outreach to them, and helping them feed them. I know there's many grants out there. They start by helping the needy and the homeless. A lot of programs are out there, but they also, a lot of homeless, most of these programs don't allow them, they don't help them much because there's a lot of things that they need to give out, give to the information that they had to give, where a lot of them don't have. A lot of them people out there that become homeless, they have been in drugs. Because of it, sometimes they don't help them in these programs that they have grants. They try to stop themselves. Some of them, they are okay because they have been evicted from the apartment. They have nowhere to go, so they become homeless as well. Ms. Yolanda Mendoza has helped them by giving them assistance with feeding them and clothing them. We are now in Reed and Washington Street because we used to do them on River Road, Riverfront. Now that is called, we are over here in Reed and Washington. What we try to do is maybe some way, I feel that maybe cut the middleman, you know, and give this money to the needy people, or come out there and really see them that they are homeless. They need help. And I feel that they need to stop this, getting grants and on behalf of them and not helping them. You know, they need help. They really need help. And then there's too many homeless out there. And sometimes some of these people don't even know what's going on, and they use them in order to get grants out of their situation, and they're not helping them at all. You know, they're not giving them, we are. We helping them. Come and see them. Be there on Wednesdays and Sundays. Come and see how these people need help. Thank you so much. They do need help.
Thank you, Juana.
Ashes to beauty.
Thank you, Juana. Our next speaker this evening is Evelyn Morrison, and the topic is Community Development Block Grant. Good evening, Evelyn. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, President of Council, and all of the council members and the administrative staff. My concern tonight is about the Community Development Block Grant. What we discovered in the two-day public hearing is that the county and the city is working together as partners, and the county is not such a good partner simply because when any type of federal allocations or state allocations are awarded, then that recipient must be in compliance. The county of Berks is not in compliance because it's a government agency that is in non-compliance in their EEO 1, 2, 3, and 4. And that is their employment designations from the county commissioners on down for the large number of employees. They have predominantly all Caucasian males in the administrative capacities, and in the general labor force is where the people of color are. So it's imbalanced and it's non-compliant. I didn't do the research on the city, so I'm not sure what that looks like. But anytime you have a contract like that, the first thing you have to do is make sure that it is governed by the CFR, which is the federal regulations that govern any type of involvement with government entities, as well as contracts. And that's another issue in terms of community development. When we look at the contracts that develop any type of building or involving employment, we have to make sure that the contractors are also in compliance, because they do get points for being in compliance in terms of hiring the people of color, and also women, and also local people. So my point is, in terms of Community Development Block Grant, we're finding that two things are happening. The same agencies are receiving three and four pots of funding, one from each area, whether it's Community Development Block Grant, or the ESG, or the homes. And what we're seeing is that those places are promoting homelessness, not preventing. And the three factors in the community development fundable activities, the national objectives are to benefit low and moderate income persons. And what we're finding is that a lot of the funds are being used for other than low and moderate income persons. The second national objective is to prevent or eliminate blight. We find that our city, Reading, and the Reading redevelopment and the Berks County development have been awarded homes either by a dollar purchase or a minimal fee, and then they're given community development block grant money to rehab them, and now they're scheduled to be, they're on the blighted list, and now they're scheduled to be demoed, all funded by public monies. So it's a waste of public money to award these nonprofits that say that they're benefiting low income, but they do not. And then also to the third objective is to meet the needs in terms of health and welfare, and not that are threatened. In a lot of the communal living, you have a rise of tuberculosis, you have a rise of lice, you have a rise of bed bugs, and that is not providing prevention in terms of health and welfare of these clients. So I think we really need to look at it. So we the people have decided that when we do meet with HUD, we're going to ask them to suspend 2017 funding until these things are investigated and that they would be able to monitor in the way of programmatic. Because every agency that receives public funds, their EEO 1, 2, and 3 is in violation and in non-compliance. So we're putting good money after bad. So I think we need to look at that. Just like our budget, we really need to look at it simply because that IT that you found, David, you didn't find it. You and the controller, those funds were already there. They just weren't recorded like they should have been. So you didn't discover $751,000. It was always there. And that was my point the last time I spoke, that we needed to look at the IT departmental allocations in this budget. There are other things in this budget that really needs to be scrutinized, but I'm just one person. But I just thank you for allowing me the time to speak.
Thank you, Evelyn. Our next speaker is, I'm going to try to read this, is it Carol Riley? Oh. Regarding epilepsy?